rents. And thank you everyone who stayed here. Good evening. I would like to give you a presentation based on a survey by the High School of Economics. I have two wonderful co-authors, Alina Ivnova and Diana Kaiki. One of my co-authors is present here. And I will talk a bit about what stood behind our research. Our presentation was a bit different from the previous ones because we are only focused on children. And in this case, our target audience was the first graders, that are children who only came to school. We looked at how they developed during their first year in school. And I'm talking about the development of math abilities. Everyone mentioned here today about how important math is, and from a researcher's point of view, the tradition is to talk about two major areas of such research and predictors in math achievements. On the one hand, we have a lot of sociological, educational, and psychological surveys, which are focused on researching social factors, that is, how the socio-economic family status is connected with the child's mathematical achievements. A lot has been said about the fact that boys are different from girls in math in terms of their achievements and strategies they use for resolving different mathematical problems. And there's also cognitive psychologists who survey the cognitive predictors of math achievements. But there has been much fewer research involving the understanding of how those two big classes of math predictors can interact with each other and how they can be connected with mathematical development. So this is the problem that we tackled in our survey. At first, I made a summary of the previous surveys. A lot has been said about the socioeconomic status of families. It can be measured differently. I'm talking about the parents' education, their income, their cultural legacy. Many different indicators can be used to measure the socioeconomic status, SES. And this SES is one of the most important factors affecting mathematical achievements. And statistics have shown that children from families with a lower SES show lower academic achievement, mathematical achievements, and also poorer reading performance. Furthermore, this SES affects the cognitive abilities of a child during his or her two or three first years of life. And children with lower family SES have worse academic achievements, worse intelligence indicators, worse memory, and so on and so forth. And once again, this can affect negatively their academic achievement. On the other hand, if we talk about cognitive psychology, as far as math is concerned, there are the so-called domain general cognitive predictors. They are the predictors that can be connected with academic achievement in any area whatsoever.
It can be about mathematics, reading, and other sciences, but here traditionally you can see, well, you can mention the following predictors like intelligence, cognitive control, working memory. And we can have also domain specific predictions, specific to specific knowledge, area of knowledge. In mathematics, such specific predictors can be, we can mention the following specific predictors: number sense, symbolic and non-symbolic, like sensitivity, watch out to the amount presented in a symbolic or non-symbolic form, and spatial ability. A domain-specific predictor for reading is phonological ability. Even though phonology and reading connection has been researched quite thoroughly, and there is a causal connection there, for the last 15 to 20 years, studies started appearing that show that phonology is an important predictor for mathematical abilities. So, what is phonology? Just a couple of words about that. Phonological ability or phonological processing, there are different terms that are used. So, it means certain sensitivity to the sound component of speech. And it is also about the ability to use these sound structures. And there are three key components of the phonological ability, the so-called phonological awareness. I don't know how to translate it into Russian better. Well, awareness that includes phonological synthesis, the ability to compose sounds into syllables and words, and phonological analysis, the ability to decompose a big sound structure into smaller parts. And another component here is a phonological memory, which is a temporary storage of phonological information or sound information in the working memory, which is very close to the understanding of phonological loop that is used in the working memory model described and suggested by Baddeley. And lexical access, that includes preserving visual information or transforming visual information into verbal information or representing it verbally and taking it from the long-term memory. And this kind of access is a rapid automated, is tested by a rapid automated naming test when a child is there's a demonstration of different symbols and visual cues, and the child has to name them quickly. So that's the understanding of phonology that we had and the notions that we used initially. If we talk about the previous research of connection between phonology and mathematics, this kind of research can be grouped into three groups. Well, the first group is called the behavioral studies. Mainly these are studies involving children with typical development that have no difficulties with intelligence, memory, and no problems with mathematical abilities. Then neuroimaging studies. It's psychophysiological research data. And then third group is researching children with dyscalculia. Children that have persistent difficulties in acquiring mathematical knowledge with proper intelligence, etc. If you talk about studies involving children with normal development, there is a number of studies here that show that phonological abilities are an important predictor of mathematical achievements. And we must say that most of these studies were done on children in kindergarten or in primary school, so on quite young children, 5 to 8 years old. Then, we've shown that phonological abilities are correspond to the successful tackling of mathematical problems, which involve keeping, preserving some mathematical facts. For instance, such arithmetic operations as addition and multiplication. They do not calculate 3 plus 2 equals 8, equals 5, but they take it from their long-term memory, the fact that it is so. There are also studies that show that phonological abilities are a predictor of basic mathematical abilities, like understanding the sequence of numbers, simple sequences, I mean, and they do not affect more complex mathematical competencies. And we are talking about these three approaches and aspects of phonological abilities. Phonological awareness is a more prominent predictor because there are some studies that prove that this is of importance. Unfortunately, this data is not always confirmed, and we have studies that show that there are no connections between phonological abilities and mathematics, and that phonological abilities is predictor of reading ability. But of course, eventually, reading abilities affect the mathematical abilities in the end. But if we control reading achievements, which some studies show that phonological abilities are not connected with mathematical abilities, and if we control some mathematical abilities, then the connection is also not that important. If we take studies of children with mathematical difficulties, it's not dyscalculia, it's difficulties. They show that if children have difficulties both with reading and with mathematics, they have lower phonological ability. But if they have difficulties with mathematics only, they don't. There is no correspondence to phonological ability. If we are talking about neuroimaging studies here, not much research has been done, but some has been done, and this research shows that there is activation of those areas in the brain that are connected with language processing during arithmetic activities, and specifically getting access to some mathematical factors from long-term memory. For instance, these areas were more activated when doing multiplication than in case of subtraction, for instance. And operation specifics is connected to the level of these areas activation. There is quite a recent study that shows that activation depends more not on the type of operation, mathematical operation, but rather on strategy. There's bigger dependency on strategy that's used when doing the operation. And if we are talking about dyscalculia, studies that are connected that are about understanding the effect of phonological abilities. Well, the studies show that lack of phonological abilities is not the key predictor for dyscalculia, but it can be an additional risk factor for dyscalculia in children. if we're talking about limitations of previous studies, both positive and negative limitations, then here we should firstly pay attention to a small number of participants or small sample size. For instance, studies involve not more than 300 participants and can have a more sociological approach and cognitive approach when we have to have certain compromise between the number of participants, number of subjects, and the depth. So balance between the depth and the accuracy of what we want to measure, of the data that we measure. For instance, phonological abilities include three aspects, and there should be quite a lot of tasks involved, therefore, and it should be one study, and it's difficult to have for a lot of participants. And there is a certain deficit of longitudinal studies that would show how phonological abilities change and how it's connected with the improvement or deterioration of mathematical achievements. And third, limitation is the lack of studies of how phonological ability changes in different groups of people. Each time we can see that there is certain effect or there is no effect, but clearly that in some situation, in different situations, we can have those abilities changing differently. And why there is an idea that SES can, SES can affect mathematical abilities. Well, there are certain studies that show that SES is an important factor, and higher SES can be a predictor of better results in reading. Again, SES affects the correspondence between spatial notions and mathematical abilities. And there are two or three studies that show that the activity, that the areas of brain, these areas of brain were more activated in higher SES participants. And with lower SES students, spatial representation areas were activated more. So all that was a foundation for our research. So our first task was to check whether phonological abilities affect the mathematical abilities when we control the reading abilities and when we control the early predictors of mathematics like knowledge of numbers. The second objective of ours was to assess the effect of different indicators of SES. For instance, we were controlling mother's education level and number of books at home and how it affects on. We were researching how it affects the math achievement during the first year of schooling. And we were trying to estimate whether the effect of phonological ability is modulated by a child's socioeconomic status. So we tried to overcome the limitations of the previous studies by having a bigger number of subjects. We had two waves only, but so it was a longitudinal study. Our study involved almost 3,000 first grade students that were surveyed twice. The first part took in September when the school year starts, and the second part was done in April. The study took place in the Tatar Republic, which gave us the opportunity to include such an important predictor as the language spoken at home. Thing is that those schools that took part in our study, in primary school, they had all the classes in Russian, but the study included children that at home spoke not only Russian, but other languages, well, mainly Tatar language. And parents were filling in the papers, when filling the papers, specified which language they use at home, and there was a certain number of children which spoke a different language at home, not Russian. So we used the Russian language version of IPIPS. It's a tool developed by the English researchers to estimate the progress during the first year of schooling, and it includes the tasks to measure mathematical achievements, reading achievements, phonological ability, and the vocabulary. So the children are assessed twice, in the beginning and the end of the year, and the scale composition allowed to estimate the progress during the school year. Apart from that, we use such an adaptation algorithm that allows decreasing the time of the testing, the tasks were structured in such a manner that their complexity was increased, and if a child made three errors in a row, then this type of task was no longer presented to the child. They moved on to a different set of tasks. And information on socioeconomic status was received from the parents. We must note that here we had only we included only the children that did the test twice and whose parents filled in the questionnaire. So to measure the mathematical achievements, we used 19 tasks, arithmetics tasks and text tasks. The predictors included phonological abilities. They were measured twice, in the beginning and at the end. Reading ability in the beginning and at the end, and there were tasks checking the knowledge of numbers and numbers were presented on the screen, and the child has to name the subject. Two digit numbers up to four digit numbers, I think, not three digit numbers. And as for SES indicators, was the number of books at home, mother's education, higher or not higher education, language spoken at home. It was fully controlled because they, according to all kinds of research, it's meaningful. These are the meaningful predictors. As for the statistical approach, since we had our study designed in a longitudinal manner, we used mixed effect growth models. So the measurements that change in time, they are considered something that's there within the individual. So thus we are able to assess changes within a single individual and between the individual, and we could assess the progress or affect predictors on outcomes, predictors that are dynamic and static. And this kind of approach allows us to assess the dependency between those two factors and the weight of it too. So some descriptive statistics for results. This is the distribution of our SES indicators. We can see that if, in terms of mother education, in mother's education, there was an even distribution. But as for language and number of books, we have a different situation.
In terms of cognitive predictors, we prepared this chart to show that there was considerable growth from the beginning to the end of the academic year. It's quite predictable. In some places, there was more considerable growth. In others, there was less growth. In terms of our congressional analysis, you can look at the results. A few comments on this table. We got results showing that even if we control the reading and number identification skills, phonology is a good predictor of math. It correlates with math development. And if we talk about SES development, we can see that only the mother's education is connected with mathematical achievement. And in terms of the gender, we can see that girls, even at the beginning of the first grade, show worse results than boys. Talking about the interaction between phonology and the time, we can see that this connection was negative. And this can be interpreted in two ways. We can see that the phonology effect is reduced from time one to time two. But if we look at the achievements of children with different phonological capabilities, we can see that this growth was a bit less for children with a high phonology level. And there are some unexpected results showing that children with a high level of phonology show much better results at the beginning. And therefore, there was some ceiling effect by the end of the academic year. And as a result of this effect, they have considerable progress, but it is a bit smaller than for children with a lower level of phonology. Maybe that's because of the specificity of our measurement tool. Talking about the SES effect, we looked at how this effect changed from time one to time two, from the beginning to the end of the school year. And we could see that mother's education was important for the child's achievements. And moreover, this effect keeps growing. The gap between children who had a poor education, a poorly educated mother, and children who had a highly educated mother keeps increasing by the end of the school year. Talking about how SES changes the phonology effect, we discovered that the number of books at home, which can be seen as an indicator of cultural capital, it's not really connected to the math achievements, but it can change the phonology effect. And children who have higher cultural capital indicator had better results. And there is a difference between children with different number of books at home. And this results in different phonology levels. The same regards the effect of phonological ability for pupils with other languages at home, not only Russian. Children who have other languages at home show the same mathematical ability levels. But this phonological ability contribution in math was higher for those pupils who spoke not only Russian at home. They can be called bilinguals, even though they are not really bilinguals in the full sense of this word. But those children are more sensitive to the level of phonology. To sum up our findings, We chose a large selection of children using mixed effect models, and we could see that the phonology effect is improved in accordance or in connection with improvement in math abilities. And this means that phonology, well, we checked it in another survey, but phonology has a direct effect, not by reading, but it is considerably, it has a direct connection to math abilities. The more phonology level, the better math abilities, and it's not even connected with reading. Now we could debate a little bit about the following. If we are interested in the early math development, this means that we need to take into account not just the specific math knowledge and skills. We should also pay attention to the development of phonological abilities. And the second point, which could be important when planning different curricula, reducing the social inequality and economic inequality. When we talk about children with a lower SES and about what to do with them, maybe when we plan the school programs, we need to take into account the fact that those children are less sensitive to verbal instruction and math problems. They do not perceive math problems in the verbal form. Sometimes we try explaining something to those children, but they don't understand. Maybe we need to use more visual tools, illustrations, visualizations, and so on. That's it. Thank you very much. Are there any questions from the audience? Does anyone still have questions? Yes, please. The question is not being asked into the mic. My name is Daily Kegel. I am from Israel. I'm a tester of educational problems, and I am a teacher for children and adults who have learning problems. And I was really interested in your presentation. I would like to share my knowledge and experience in this regard. We do didactic tests in order to determine why does a child with normal intelligence fails in some subjects or in a specific subject. For example, in subjects which need verbal processing of a material, or maybe in exact sciences and subjects and maths. As for neuropsychology, I'm sorry about my problems with the Russian language, but neuropsychologists tell us that sometimes people have problems with math while excelling at verbal sciences or vice versa. There is no correlation, or the correlation does not always exist between precise or exact sciences and verbal sciences. When learning math, we need visualization, which includes and involves the memory and the processing of visual material. And here there is a very direct link between those two values. The ability for visual and spatial imagery and math ability. Furthermore, the speed of naming numbers and figures also helps in math. And it's very different from the speed of naming letters. And it is considered, and we know that for a fact, that these are the indicators that can't be changed. They are there since birth. So a child who succeeded in naming letters can have a very low result in the test involving naming numbers. And then this child can have big problems with maths. Are you talking about your pedagogical experience or about your research's experience? I'm talking about what I was taught about the surveys that are the basis for the didactic testing that we do. And I have a lot of experience in this area. I believe in this. I'm telling you about what I know. I'm not debating this. I just wanted to point out another opinion, if you allow me. There's another question. We actually wanted to relate that to the presentation and ask your questions regarding the presentations, because we are going to have a cocktail party later where we can network and tell everyone who does what. So let's ask the questions. I think there is a difference. I did not formulate a question. I just focused your attention on the fact that there is a difference between what we saw in the presentation and what I know. There is some difference, I don't know why. And I would like to point out that I talked to Anna Schwartz, the chairperson of this conference, and even children who came from Ethiopia, who were born in Ethiopia, who don't have any language background at home, who don't have any mathematical education, but very often those children from Ethiopia show great understanding of math and great achievements in math. To put it in simple Russian, what God gives you, you can't buy that in a pharmacy. And I would like to conduct a survey regarding that. I hope I will succeed in that. Thank you very much for this very interesting results of your survey. I think I've mentioned that phonology or any language abilities are not the only and unique predictor of math achievements. Of course, spatial imagery has importance. The speed of processing information has importance. But there are also other predictors. And if we talk about children who have the same level of spatial imagery but a different level of phonology, and those who have better phonology will have better results in maths. Furthermore, if we talk about specific math predictors, we checked the knowledge of numbers, the naming of numbers that you mentioned, and even when controlling those abilities, phonology is still important. So I believe that we cannot neglect those language processes when studying maths and learning maths. We cannot neglect and ignore them because there's an additional factor, that is an additional factor that is important too. I have a question. Do we have practicing teachers and deans of maths in this room? If we talk about a study being useful to the practitioners, do we need to learn more rhymes and poems as early as we can? Do we need to read more? Will that help in studying maths? Is it a question to me or the practitioners? Well, of course, maths cannot be developed separately from language development. Those processes are interconnected. and they are more interconnected in early childhood. In secondary school, that can be more separate from each other than in kindergarten or in primary school. But if we want to develop mathematics separately and reading abilities separately, we need to take into account that if we want to develop math only in primary school, we should also think about developing reading abilities. Your question, please. Good afternoon. Thank you very much for your very interesting presentation. I understand that there are different factors involving abilities to maths. But my question is as follows. You are saying that the social status has an impact. And if the social status is high, the math competences are better on average. Maybe that's right, but I work at a private school where there are families with a high socioeconomic status, with a good financial situation, but there are a lot of problems with math. So has there been any research, any comments maybe? Thank you for your question. I'm not talking about abilities. I'm talking about achievements, the results of learning. That's not the same thing. Secondly, we understand that during the teaching, many factors can have a role, not only the SES. The SES alone only means that parents with a higher SES can give more resources to their child. Of course, there is a difference between children with a high SES and with a low SES. Of course, the difference, that gap, can be compensated by the school itself, by different curricula, by different strategies. There is a study that shows that in Russia, for some reason, that's a tradition here. There is a PISA study, maybe you heard about it. Pupil Program International Student Assessment, the PISA study, which shows that in Russia, actually, children with a higher SES show less dynamics in terms of years. And our colleagues from the High School of Economics are trying to understand why. Children with a higher SES do not improve their results as quickly as children with lower SES. Maybe that's because of our policy of pushing children up to a certain level. In most schools, there is no goal of ensuring great progress for children who have a richer parents. If children have parents with a high SES, it's their concern. So SES as itself doesn't ensure achievement. It's not a guarantee of achievement. There's one more thing. A year ago, we went on a business trip to England. And in England, there are schools with a pretty high academic level. And the director of that school said that 90% of their children are migrants from India and other countries, and we ask him why there are so few children, why there are so few British children in that school. And that director answered, well, the British children don't need to really work hard. It's very difficult to work here, and those richer British children will not work hard.
Maybe there is a matter of motivation here, but there is a lot of room for interpreting here. I can tell you anything about motivation. speaking of our data, yes, maybe children are less motivated. Well, I know that in Russia there is research that shows that for children with higher socioeconomic status, career in STM is not a desirable career or prestigious career. They do not envisage themselves working in such areas where you need a good math knowledge of mathematics. Well, maybe now things are changing, but so high socioeconomic status children want to be legal lawyers, bankers, working in the government, etc. A question. Well, if I may, I'll comment on the previous question. If I remember that, I remember your presentation correctly, the only indicator of socioeconomic status that was a predictor in math achievement was parental education. Yes, well, mother's education. I conducted research dedicated to the same subject, and in the US, it's a more topical matter because the difference between the low level and high level is more dramatic. And of course, SAS and achievement are correlated. So it's a general trend and doesn't mean that every child of a high income person will be good in mathematics or vice versa, but there is a correlation. But apart from that, we need to understand that socioeconomic status includes two components that have a different effect on mathematical achievements. It's education. If majority of the children in your school went there because their parents were able to afford such school, it doesn't mean yet that they have a high level of education. And education is the component of an SAS that correlates to math achievement most. And apart from that, in Russia, I think those families that have low income, these families have access to the preschool education system that partially compensates for SES effect. And again, if we look at the American preschoolers, low SES and high SES families, they have very different access, and so access to primary school does not compensate for this SES factor. And I think you also had the question, right? Or okay, then we can say that the first.